In this video, we give a demonstration of a prototype software for extracting metadata from historical maps. Historical maps are typically cataloged by title, authors, and year of publication. However, there is a distinct lack of metadata when it comes to the actual contents of these maps. Let's see how our system can help. First, we pick a map from our repository of scanned historical documents. Here, we go for a cropped section of a map from the early 18th century. Historical maps contain all kinds of information. This map, for instance, shows territories and some landscape topography, that is, pictograms of trees and hills, as well as rivers. In addition, there is information on settlements. Much like in modern maps, these are depicted by place markers and corresponding text labels. Our ultimate goal is to automatically understand the contents of a map like this. However, getting semantics right is a genuinely hard problem for computers. Therefore, we focus on smaller goals, for example, locating and identifying settlements. For this purpose, we are especially interested in the labels. If we were able to read them automatically, we could generate a searchable list of contained places for any given map. We cannot expect off-the-shelf OCR software to work well in this setting. For one, the labels are handwritten. And also, segmentation is hard. How to distinguish text labels from the other map elements, some of which may even overlap. As a first step towards finding labels, we focus on finding occurrences of individual characters. We will now extract a character A. We start by indicating, for example, this A over here. In the top right, you see a live preview of what is being cropped. Once we are satisfied with the crop, we start the template matching algorithm. This algorithm gives us a list of matches and tells us how good it thinks each one of them is. This is displayed using a green to red color coding. The best match, of course, is the template itself. Here are some other good matches that indeed show the character A. But clearly, not all matches do, such as over here and over here. This happens because the template matching algorithm is purely image-based and cannot distinguish whether a match actually shows the character A or not. We could now inspect every match by hand and throw out the incorrect ones, but this would be very time-consuming. Instead, the system uses active learning to speed up this process. Here we see 9 matches, with a little bit of their surroundings. The user is asked to click on any of the matches that show the character A. This one over here does, so we select it. One can imagine how the algorithm was tricked into believing some of these other matches were an A, but it's fairly easy for a human to pick the correct ones. Now we are done with this batch, and we click Next. We're presented with a new set of matches and continue. This time, we don't have any hits, though the bottom right match might look tempting if you're not familiar with German place names. We hit Next without selecting anything. Now, with these matches, we get closer to an A than with most of what we saw in the previous steps. In the top row, there are 2 actual A's. Also, we are presented with a bunch of G's and D's, which contain within them the shape of an A. Some literature suggests grouping these characters, but in this example we will stick to just the A's. Here we have 5 out of 9 A's, but still some incorrect matches. It seems like some learning is happening. Actually, let's rewind to the first step and see what was happening under the hood. We're back at the start, but this time, we open the debug panel. The important part is the diagram on the top right. It has space for all matches, sorted from left to right according to their quality. If we know whether a match is correct or not, we draw a blue dot. If it's correct, it goes on top. If it's incorrect, it goes on the bottom. We start by assuming the 9 best matches are correct, and the 9 worst matches are wrong. The curve fits the blue dots using logistic regression. We classify a match as being correct if the curve is above 1/2. Right now, we would classify all these matches as correct, and all of these matches is false. We now use an active learning strategy called uncertainty sampling. It means that the system is going to present those matches it is least certain about, which are, in this case, the 9 matches you see on the left. Now we input step 1 again, and we see that our answers show up in the diagram. This also leads to an updated curve. The point where the curve crosses 50% has shifted to the left, because 8 out of 9 matches were negative. In this iteration, there were no A's at all. We click Next, and the diagram is updated. Step 3 had some A's again. And now we are back at the point that we decided to rewind from. Note that when we submit this batch, the curve will hardly change. The active learning has identified an area that contains correct as well as incorrect matches, for which the user input is particularly helpful. The matches to the left are presumably all correct, and as we saw, the matches to the right were mostly wrong. User effort is now being concentrated on the difficult transition area between the two. This process is pretty quick, so we're going to do a couple more batches. Giving the system more information improves the quality of the results. In our experience, it is sufficient to do somewhere between 5 and 10 batches. The time a user needs to spend on a template this way is typically well within a minute. We have done 8 iterations now, which should be enough. Our final classifier is as follows. If the user classified the match for us, we take his or her answer. Otherwise, we classify based on the final version of the curve. Let's see what this looks like on the map. Back in the map view, we now only see the positive matches. That is, positive according to the user's decision or to the predictions of the algorithm. We can see that the classification did quite well. A large majority of the matches actually shows the character A. Still, there are some false positives. For example, this D and this G. Also, some A's are missing. For example, this one. Overall, classification performance is good. In this area of the map, we started with 122 matches. Almost all of them were classified automatically. The active learning algorithm only asked us about these 9 matches and did the rest of the work for us. This approach not only works for characters, we can also use it to find, for example, place markers. Here's a template we prepared earlier. We have cropped and classified one of these little towers. As you can see, this also works well. Another option is to locate woodlands by searching for tree pictograms. As you can see here, the forest areas stick out quite prominently. At this point, it would make sense to cluster matches. We could group trees into forests and characters into labels. However, our software doesn't support this yet. Another direction for future work is distributing the workload that goes into classification. This user interaction was designed to be well-suited for small display devices. This may enable crowdsourcing applications. The additional user input can be fed into the learning algorithm, which improves classification performance. As a byproduct of using our software, we end up having many examples of different characters. Let's look at all those A's that we just classified. In this interface, we select the map, then we select the template, and it shows us all the positive matches. A list like this has many applications, for example, in training OCR software. Now you've seen the various functions of our system. We hope you enjoyed this quick demo and say thanks for watching. If you're interested in more technical details, check our website. There's a link in the description below. Last but not least, we say thanks to Dr. Schmidt of the Würzburg University Library. He provided us with the beautiful historical map you've been looking at.